yet. I think so now. I think now. Or now?
Now or then now?
Then now. Maybe now.
And now, on with the show.
Time for bladder check. Check.
Check?
Check. Wait. Screw it. I'm holding it. Time for bladder check. Check.
Check?
Check. Wait. Screw it. I'm holding it.
Podcasting, the final audio frontier. These are the legends of Brown Squadron.
Our computer is picking up a strange signal. Here, sir, you better take a look at it.
The ongoing mission? To explore the Star Wars universe and other nerd culture topics. To seek new content and new cantinas, bars, and lounges. To boldly annoy Scruffy by making too many bad jokes. Welcome to the Hyperspace Heroes Podcast.
All right, now. All right.
Now.
Welcome to Hyperspace Heroes. This is Brown Leader signing in. All wings report in.
Hey, just Brown 4 tonight.
It is just Brown 4.
Scruffy, I get to move up now?
Nope, we're leaving yet Brown 4.
But hey, that was a nice play in the whole Spaceballs who's on first bit, you know?
I know, yeah.
When will then be now?
Mm-hmm. Oh, man. Well, welcome to episode 81 of Hyperspace Heroes, or that would be 106 on the Spotchka scale. And tonight, as you can see, Scruffy's not joining us, but we do have a guest. We're going to talk about Bad Batch tonight. We're going to talk about the brand new Tales of the Empire trailer that just dropped out of nowhere today on the interwebs. Very exciting. We're going to talk about that. And we're 6 months out from ICCC and going back down there. So we're calling it. Portion of this is kind of a road to ICCC. We've invited some guests other pods that we met down at the show last year. And tonight, our third person joining us is going to be from the show that we met last year. And we're going to bring him on in a minute. And so we're going to talk about that. And those two double drop Bad Batch episodes. That's all I got to say about that.
Wow.
For now. And then we've got I put together a little tribute for something that occurred in those episodes, and we'll be playing that tonight as well. So, all right. So, to get into the discussion, let's bring in our guest tonight. Our guest is the host of the Headless Ned Stark podcast. You can find him, I think, primarily on YouTube. You can find him on all of the social medias. And let's welcome in Terry from the Headless Ned Stark podcast.
Welcome, Terry. Soon. I was trying to get it in there. You guys are doing it. When will then be now?
Soon.
What's up, guys? How you guys doing?
Welcome. Yeah, good. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Absolutely. Yeah. This will be fun.
So why don't you tell our... I'm off track already. That you can see how professional we are on this show.
And you have been listening to Hyperspace Heroes.
So Headless Ned Stark podcast, obviously Game of Thrones fan, right? Coming up with the name there. But why don't you tell our viewers and our listeners a little bit about your show?
Yeah, so primarily on YouTube. I drop videos weekly, 3 to 4 videos. I do a couple lives. But basically, I came up with the channel like a lot of people did during COVID. I had the idea of, I like talking Star Wars. I like talking Game of Thrones. So let's combine the two. Why not? And so my favorite Funko Pop, actually, and I know we'll get the collectibles later on, but Headless Ned Stark is my favorite Funko Pop I have. So nice. I'm like, yeah, that'd be kind of a cool YouTube name, I think. And then I got the Star Wars background. So I combined the two. Basically Game of Thrones and the Star Wars content is probably most of the channel, but I also work with a co-host on some of my Sunday night lives. usually around 7 p.m. But when there's a show on, we break it down after the show. So, for example, we just got done breaking down The Ones Who Live. Now, I don't know if you guys saw this. This is the new Walking Dead series that just ended that brought back Rick and Michonne. And I'll tell you what, it is some of the best television I've seen in a long time because it was a really good show. So we break that kind of stuff down. We've broken down The Last of Us. We've broken down all the Star Wars movies. We did reaction reviews of all the Clone Wars, all the Rebels episodes. And we, I think we're going to be doing Overwatch. What am I thinking of? What's it called? The new, based off the video game. Not Halo, the other one. Oh, I can't remember the name of it. What am I thinking of? I don't know, but it's coming on Amazon Prime. I can't remember the name of it.
Oh, Fallout.
Fallout. Thank you. Yes, Fallout. We're going to be breaking those episodes down starting here very shortly. I think it starts April 22nd.
Yeah, I might have to get Prime. I don't have Prime, and I might have to get it just for that because I was a huge Fallout fan.
It's funny. I never really play the game, but when I saw the cast, I'm like, I got to watch this. Mm-hmm. Like Kyle MacLachlan is in there. And if you don't know who that is, he is from Twin Peaks. And that's one of my other big ones that I've started doing on the channel. And as I just, last summer, we actually drove out to, we're in Cleveland. So we drove all the way out to Suquamish, Washington. Ooh. And that was part of our vacation. And I hit hours and hours and hours of footage just going around to all the filming locations. We actually went into the main house. Have you guys ever seen Twin Peaks?
Not I have a not. Long time.
Long time ago. Well, the one main house there still stands, and there's someone who lives there, and she was gracious enough to allow us to come in. We were there for like an hour and a half. We filmed. She gave us so many details. So I I basically created a one-hour documentary or video essay, if you will, on all of the Twin Peaks stuff. So Twin Peaks, for me, that show is the show that started it all. That show is what was able to bring us shows like Lost. That brought us shows like Breaking Bad. That brought us Game of Thrones. It was that continuous storyline that we didn't really get to ever see in the 90s. And that's why I love that series. And I say pop culture is probably the main focus of the channel, with Star Wars and Game of Thrones being the most. And then I do a lot of stuff on cons. Like I said, I met you guys down at ICCC. This will be my third year going, and I think it's October this year. Mm-hmm. And and collectibles. So kind of like everything. The YouTube algorithm, I think, hates me because I do a little too much, I think. But it's fine.
That's how we are on TikTok right now. All of a sudden, about a couple weeks ago, I went from, I don't know, probably 800-900 views down to like 2
yeah.
and 4. And I'm like, whoa. Let's jump over to the chat really quick. We've got a few people in the chat, and good old Rural Farm Boy. Episode 106, the true timeline. So whenever we talk about episodes 106, that kind of thing on the Spotchka timeline, that is his timeline, because we were used to be under another show name where we did 25 episodes, and he counts those as part of our library. So and then let's see. Brick City Blockade Podcast saying hello there, General Grievous and our General Kenobi. And I forgot to mention last week when we had Wade on. So whenever I send out invites to people, I always start with hello there. And Wade is the only person that's ever responded with General Kenobi first and foremost in all of the invites I've ever sent. So kudos to Wade on that. My oldest son chiming in and letting me know I can borrow his Prime. So I appreciate that. Thank you very much. But
very nice of him.
Right. When we had originally set this up, we were going to talk about the latest two episodes of Bad Batch, episodes 10 and 11, Identity Crisis and Point of No Return. But I think first what we've got to talk about is the big news today. I'm sorry. Yes.
We've missed all the requisite stuff with the new guest.
We have. All right, Terry, let me go back. I apologize. So first question we always ask all of our guests, what does Star Wars mean to you?
Yeah. So, you know, it's just hard because, like, I was just telling a buddy of this last weekend, actually, And he's like, you know, he's like, you do this YouTube thing, and you know, it's like, you know, you don't have a huge following. I'm like, no, I don't have a huge following, but I do it because I like it. He's like, well, why? And I said, well, you know, here's the thing. When I was growing up, okay, so I was born in 76. So I'm like, what, 24 years old, I think. So
I like your thinking.
Yeah. one of my first memories is my dad taking me to see The Empire Strikes Back in 1980. And I just remember sitting up at that screen. And when you see those giant AT-ATs coming through that snow, like, it just sticks with you. I mean, that's probably my first memory of Star Wars, honestly, is that part. And it's like going all the way through the original trilogy. And then, you know, I graduate high school and I'm in college, and, you know, you just kind of look for things to do at night sometimes, right? Because, you know, study. Who wants to study? No, kids, stay in school. So what did I do at night, at midnight, at 1 a.m.? I'm on StarWars.com, and I'm just looking up anything I can find that's new. I'm looking up all the EU stuff. I can't even tell you the hours and hours and hours that I spent looking at all that EU stuff. You know, and then it's just, to me, it is what I don't want to say I base my life on it, but there's so much that my life is based on that is due to Star Wars. I mean, behind me, you can't see over here, but I have a huge wall of autographed Funko Pops from pretty much almost every actor. My basement is full of stuff. I got Lego ships. I got the Razor. I mean, I got Old Millennium Fall, everything. My wife loves this room. That's why I got my own room. And, but yeah, you know, it means a lot. And it really crushes me when we get something like the Kenobi show. Like, I don't know how you guys felt about that, but I absolutely hated what they did in that show. And I hate being negative, because I don't want to be negative about it. I like to voice my opinion, though. And because, like, you know, like you were talking today, we dropped an amazing trailer. And as much as I am looking forward to watching The Acolyte, I watched both these trailers back to back. It doesn't even compare. For me, the new trailer today from Tales of the Empire just blows the Acolyte one out of the air, you know, out of the water. And it's like, it's frustrating, because, like, why can't that is Star Wars? What we got today, that is Star Wars. And that's what we grew up with. Mm-hmm. And that's what I remember. And, you know, I'm not the biggest sequel trilogy fan. The prequel trilogy fan. I do really like Revenge of the Sith. The first two movies were fine for what they were. But the sequels, I was a big Force Awakens fan. I saw that thing 6 times in the theater. I loved it. And maybe it was because we missed Star Wars for so long. But, man, when Last Jedi came out, it crushed me what they did to those characters. And then Rise of Skywalker was just, you know, it was it was basically two directors fighting against each other. And it's just unfortunate that movie was just terrible. Mm-hmm. But, you know, Mando brought us back a little bit too. But yeah, it's hard for me to see the potential of what they can do with Star Wars. And then some of the stuff they give us, and it's just like, what, mm-hmm. You know, I don't know. So it does mean a lot to me. That's why I made a YouTube channel. It's really the main reason why I did, you know? So,
yeah, we're, you know, Kenobi, I'm kind of indifferent on it. If of all the live action, we've talked about this before on our show, of all the live action, I actually rated at the bottom, not because it was horrible, just because we didn't really need it, in my opinion. I think it was a time period. Granted, I love seeing Ewan as Kenobi. I mean, I loved him. That was probably one of my favorite parts of the prequels, was Ewan's performance as Kenobi in all three movies. And you know, so and his portrayal with the PTSD and everything, and I get it was great. It was fine. It was just, I don't just like, yeah, I agree with you. I think the trailer, which we'll talk about in a minute, animation is really killing it. I think they're really, really bringing Star Wars home.
Rebels and Clone Wars are just, when I tell people, like, you really got to watch it, and it gets cartoons for kids. I'm like, yeah, some of it is. Mm-hmm. Like, there's always those episodes that are going to be more geared toward kids, or just, you know, your little easy little stories are easy to follow. But, like, mm-hmm. people don't understand, like, because like when, like, I did a couple videos on my channel, I did like some watch order videos, and I'm like, we're more like essential viewing, I guess, for, you know, to keep with the lore or whatever. I mean, like the Mortis arc. I mean, how good is that? Mm-hmm. Like, it's so good, and you know they're gonna connect it in Ahsoka season two. Like, yeah, I mean, if they don't do that, talk about another miss. I mean,
right?
You know, they're I think they already messed up in Ahsoka, you know, with the whole Sabine using the Force. I don't know why we needed that. I don't think we needed that. I don't know. I wasn't crazy about that, but overall, I did like Ahsoka.
Yeah. Know. I again, it felt more like Star Wars, traditional Star Wars in a way. You know, it had some of that campiness. And yeah, Sabine's Force using, I could leave it or take it. I'm indifferent to it. It doesn't bother me, but I don't hate it. You know, I liked Ezra's performance. I thought he did a great job. You know, I would have enjoyed seeing more of him. Balin, how do we not, you know, love Balin?
Yeah, got, you know, R.I.P. Ray, because I mean, that guy, honestly, man, he kind of made the show for me. I mean,
yeah,
he was incredible.
Yeah, I almost changed our name to Skull Squadron for a while because it was just Balin was such an outstanding character for sure.
Yeah,
DB, you had a follow-up question.
Well, the follow-up question is, what was your first Star Wars experience? And you kind of touched on it, seeing Empire in the theater.
Yeah, I was Empire in the theater, and then, you know, after that, obviously collecting the toys, man. Like, you know, now being a 47-year-old man, it would have been nice to keep those in the packages. Because now I go to these cons and I'm like, wait, what? What's happening now? I could have gotten bored with that.
Yep.
You know, half of them were, the hands were probably chewed off. And but yeah, like it is funny though, during COVID, because couldn't do anything. Mm-hmm. The one thing I did convince my wife was we went to this, it's about an hour away, this like local, like, you know, toy store or like a, I don't know, just whatever you would call it, you know, reseller or whatever. I don't know what the term is, but it's just a store. And I did pick up my my OG Empire Strikes Back Millennium Falcon, so that was good. But that, I don't have much. I don't know where it went, man. It kills me. It absolutely kills me.
Yeah, I don't have any of my original stuff either. The guys do though. They have a lot of their original.
I have my complete collection.
That's awesome.
From when I was a child. And I'm so grateful that when I got older and moved out, you know, my parents packed everything back up. I still have the original boxes they came in and everything, which my mom thought I was nuts. But now I watch these boxes go for a couple hundred bucks online. It's
absolutely,
you know,
insane.
But I'm very grateful my parents kept all my stuff together. And now, you know, finally in my late 30s, if you'll buy that, late 40s. Anyway, I finally have stuff on display. You can kind of see it behind me there. But I finally have, you know, the nerd cave I've always wanted. So, yeah, no, the toys are fantastic. And I still, you know, I look for good deals online. So,
yeah,
I mean, the IC, you know what we're talking about. So.
Yeah, right, it's absolutely crazy. I mean, He-Man and G.I. Joe and Turtles. I don't know where any of it is. And we sold that house like almost a decade ago at this point. So, and we cleaned it out, and that's one thing I was definitely looking for. So I don't know. She must have got rid of it. I don't know.
Right.
She'll never admit it.
All right. Let's move over to Tales of the. I almost said Tales of the Jedi. Tales of the Empire just dropped. The trailer dropped today. The poster dropped first. We're gonna get six stories, three of Barriss Offrey and three of Morgan Elsbeth. And as you can see in the poster a little bit there, we've got Thrawn in the background, a younger Thrawn, and then we've got some Inquisitors. Somebody today, I think it was it Matt? Matt. Over at Yubcast, who's a friend of ours. Funniest thing I saw about it all day today, posted on Twitter. He said that they changed the look of the head Inquisitor they changed the shape of his head from the live action series. And what a bold choice that was to do that.
Oh, very nice, cool. Matt. Nice.
So kudos to you, Matt. That was I think you won the internet for the day, in my opinion. But that and somebody else showed, I guess Thrawn looks younger in that, and did a picture of him from Rebels and was talking about quite the glow up that he had from what we're going to see in this series to Rebels. But yeah, let's kind of go around, guys. What did you, Terry? What did you think about the trailer?
Yeah, you know, like I said, like as soon as I started watching it, the first shot you get, the three Star Destroyers, and it's the wide shot. Like, where is those shots in our shows? Like, we don't get that stuff. Like, and I get it. Like, this is animation. You can pretty much do what you want. And I understand that. But, like, I don't – I guess that is – not to totally go off the trailer, but that is one of my biggest issues with the Star Wars shows is that the scale just seems so small. You know?
Yeah.
But yeah, the trailer, I mean, Barriss Offee, I made a video on her. Oh man, this is a while ago. It's an older video on my channel. And I mean, she is one of my favorite characters, and it's like, she just disappears. You don't ever hear anything about it. And then I was so disappointed that, cause I thought she was going to turn up in Ahsoka season one. I thought she was Merrick. For the longest time, I thought that was Merrick. And then, you know, Merrick was dust.
Night Sister Gas. Yeah.
Yeah. Jeez. Oh man. That was horrible. God, whatever.
Well, you know, that was one of I actually think that was one of the best parts of Ahsoka was it got us guessing. It got us,
yeah,
you know, who was Marok? And I know on this show, I love to speculate on just who is this, who is that. In the thumbnail for this episode, I showed that Shadow, the CX trooper, and I put a little arrow on the thumbnail, said, is that Ezra? Yeah. Because you know, everybody thought Marok, or a lot of people thought Marok was Ezra back then. And it was just that's half the fun, because all three of us grew up during the dark times and all we had was speculation on a lot of things. And so I love guessing. I love having fun with it. And I don't mind being wrong. I mean, obviously, but like,
during that Ahsoka series, that was one of the most fun times I had making content, because you were able to theorize, you could make predictions. You could always be wrong. Most of the time we are wrong, but it was really fun. And like, see, and like, I didn't have that fun with Mando season three. I didn't have that fun with Kenobi. I had to go back all the way to Mando 2. And Mando 2, I didn't even have a YouTube channel yet. So that was, for me, that was a lot of fun, Ahsoka. But yeah, I mean, you know, and then we getting more with Morgan Elsbeth, which I'm really, really excited about that, because I think I didn't really love her character in Mando season two. I was like, who's this? But her break coming back in Ahsoka was great. And then we got to, now we get to see this. Plus, I met the actress. She's fantastic. Met her at New York Comic Con last October. Actually, meeting her next week at the Cleveland Comic Expo. And I actually got my Funko Pop right here.
Nice.
Getting
oh, excellent.
Nice.
Yeah, so I got that picked up. And yeah, so I'm excited for that. And, you know, just to see Grievous again, I mean, that's cool. Getting some of these characters that we haven't really seen too much of. And you know, I guess like Grand Inquisitor's back, and of course the final scene with Vader just walking in, and then you get the the first brother? Is that who that the first one is?
And then in the background is Marok, and the Inquisitor voiced by Clancy Brown that was in Ahsoka's Tales of the Jedi.
Right. That was the first one, and then the one closest to us on the screen. I think that's the fourth sister.
Yeah,
who is in Kenobi briefly, but she's in it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was one thing I was disappointed about Kenobi was the Inquisitors. I thought they didn't have enough budget, I think, left to really make them as cool as they could have been.
They did not need to bring Reva in. It was a horrible character. Mm-hmm. No development. There was no need. You have Inquisitors. Why are we having to bring a brand new person in?
She like, took
let the Grand Inquisitor run that show.
No development. She took a lightsaber twice and survived. That's development.
But we're not here to talk about
right. Yeah, yeah. It's Morgan Elsbeth. I hadn't expected that, but looking back now, the way they framed her in Ahsoka was just enough, you know. And it's like, okay, she's a Night Sister. Oh, she's a Night Sister. Well, why doesn't she look like the other Night Sisters? Why doesn't she have their power? And you know, and they did enough there. So now, Tales of the Empire, like it's showing her trauma from when the Separatists took out, when Grievous and the Droid Army took out Dathomir, which we've always heard, we've heard Asajj's side of the story, but now to hear somebody else's is pretty cool.
Yeah, and, then, and I think it's cool that they're going to show, it looks like they're going to show some old, you know, old cuts and, not, you know, old scenes that we didn't get to see in Clone Wars from that battle, but now we're going to get to see it from Morgan's side instead, which is pretty cool that they were both there at the same time. And not, it distinct though is Morgan really dead in Ahsoka? Because I would love to see her and Asajj meet up again if they were already on the, if they're on the same planet fighting for the same cause. So you know, we'll wait and see. I mean, Night Sisters, they brought back didn't they bring back Maul, or they beam his legs or something, right?
Something like that. Yeah.
They brought back his brother, I think.
Right, and then we get to see Barriss Offrey. She's going to get three stories, becoming an Inquisitor, and. We always knew what was her master they had in season one of Rebels. You know, they were using as bait the dead body held in state. And then to see what happened to her, that's actually because that was always a cool dynamic with her and Ahsoka when they were both Padawans.
They're like best friends.
Right, right. And then the betrayal, which forces Ahsoka to leave the Jedi Order and everything. But DB, let's we haven't heard what are your thoughts about the trailer?
Yes. No, I literally, you sent me that link today, and I had just watched it on my phone, and you walked by my office, and I know I was like, holy crap, what did I, that's the one and only time I watched the trailer. But it's intriguing to me because Morgan Elsbeth, to me, was a throwaway character when they introduced her.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree.
You know? Totally died. And as we've, I should know by now, nothing in the Filoniverse happens by accident. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we've seen her progress to the point where we think she's made the ultimate sacrifice, you know, to get Thrawn back. And now we're going back to see her origin story, which is overlapping with Barriss's continuation that we've been lacking all these years. Just what a neat juxtaposition to do in this series. I think it's, and you know, to quote Obi-Wan, you know, from a certain point of view, we're seeing the Empire's point of view now. Mm-hmm. You know, and villains rarely think they're bad, they just have their own motives. Mm-hmm. So this, I think, wow, what a great juxtaposition to be able to see this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very, very cool. I think we're all, I had goosebumps watching it. That's for sure. By the time it was
absolutely
done. Absolutely. It was very cool. All right. Any final thoughts before we move on to Bad Batch?
I'm just excited, and I'm glad it's only on May 4th. We went wait like 3 weeks.
I know. Right.
Whatever it is.
Cause it's somebody put a timeline up. It was like last episodes of Bad Batch on the 1st. The 2nd is to recuperate. The 3rd, the 25th anniversary of Phantom Menace comes out, and then and then on the 4th, Tales of the Empire. So, very, very. It's gonna beginning of May is gonna be. Take your heart medicine if you need
it. What's sad is I have very, very long shifts on May 3rd and May 4th. I won't get to see any of this until May 5th.
Oh, I was about to say too. May 4th is a Saturday, so
I have an event at work that will consume about 15 hours of my day.
Yeah, so. Unfortunately, yes.
Yeah, I might actually because it is a Saturday, and then they're going to drop all six episodes. I'm pretty sure at the same time. I think that's what they did for Tales, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I might just do a watch party on YouTube. Why not?
There you go. There you go. All right. Let's flip over into Bad Batch. All right. Bad Batch season 3, episode 10, Identity Crisis. You know, they could have posted these episodes separately, and I think we would have been okay. It's not like it was necessarily a part one and part two, but it was really good stuff. And DB, you made a comment a little bit ago about in the Filoniverse, nothing happened by accident. And the threads that they started tying together in these episodes, especially this one, Identity Crisis. Let me go through the quick summary real quick. So we start off on a planet. There's a mom and her little kid. Which when making the baby sounds later, I heard Grogu in there somewhere. They used some Grogu sound effects in there. Yeah, I know they did. They're at a market. The kid force throw something and they're like, ooh, who did that? You know, and basically they get reported to. I find it interesting. They're now using the term class one bounty hunters. It's not the first time we've heard that. And so somebody gets called to report on the kid because we know the Empire's looking for force sensitives again. And the there was something. Oh, that species, because I needed to know, was a Tarlifar. The mom and the baby, Tarlifar. And I think, according to Wikipedia, I think they might have had an appearance in Solo, A Star Wars Story, which is might be why they look somewhat familiar.
Okay.
So then we go over to Tanis. You see Hemlock looking at some new storage container, not the one that we've seen before in the vault. He closes it on the pad there on the controls. You see the shape of a person. Wondering what it is. He then leaves. It's all locked within this little tower inside the base. Meets with Carr. Carr's like, I want more responsibility. So he's like, are you sure you can handle it? She's like, yep. So he said, all right, well, you're going to take the place of Nala Se. Takes her into a different part of the vault. You think we're going back to where we saw like the other storage containers with the Sith runes and everything. But it's not. They're going into a little public space. Kind of a community area, almost looked like a prison common area, right? And there's kids in there. And this is one of the threads that Filoni's tying together. What has been one of the speculation points, which is whose blood are they testing on the clones' blood, with the clones' blood? Where are they getting the midichlorians from? Because I know I didn't, I knew it wasn't going to be the Emperor because, you know, I mean, he's only got so much blood to go around. And if you're going to test it that much, so it kind of makes sense. I was leaning like maybe they had one of the Jedi, you know, because there is a whole bunch of them in cold storage at the Inquisitorium. Maybe they had pulled some into Tantus. I don't know. But we find out that it's these force sensitive kids, and call it a retcon, call it whatever you want. But one of the cool things I thought from that was in Rebels and Clone Wars, we've had Inquisitors and others tracking down force sensitive kids. And we thought, well, maybe it's for Palpatine to make another army, new more Sith, that kind of thing. Or was it for this all along? Was it for this testing all along? Because we know Necromancer goes from this time period all the way to the sequels, or at least during the time of the Mandoverse. So thought that was an interesting thread right there. The kids all have high M counts. And they say that Omega's blood is a binder. So they've, you know, talked, finally kind of put that out there. We meet a couple of the kids, SP54, which is Eva, the little red girl with the horns, and then SP32, which is Jax. And I was like, you know, why does Jax look so familiar? And then I was like, wait a minute, it's the Green Giants kid. And Carr makes an interesting line reference during the episode. She goes, they were children like she was. And it was, again, nothing's by accident in this show. And then I thought something interesting, too, when we find out later, we see Carr goes to meet Cad Bane, gets the kid. Cad Bane gets that little kid from the village, brings that kid to join them. And I thought it was interesting. They're all kind of primary colors, which I was like, I wonder if there's anything in that. There's got to be a red one, a green one, a blue one, and a white one. Some sort of Easter egg. I don't know what.
I have a theory on that.
Yeah, go for it.
Before they brought the latest child in, the three, not to be speciesist or anything, but they were all colors, main colors of lightsabers from the original trilogy.
There you go. There you go. And then the new one's the Ahsoka variant.
It's true, you know?
Right. So then we've got Tarkin's talking to Hemlock in his office about expenditures, because it's all of the war runs on money, right? The Empire runs on money. And what was interesting, really interesting, and I had to shoot Wade a DM from Records of the Republic this morning, but originally, and I didn't get this in time to put it up in the episode, but that's the first screen he's looking at. and it matches the one that was on that storage unit that's containing whatever. And we're assuming it's the Shadow Troopers, the CX Troopers, whatever you want to call them. But then he flips the screen and the helmet changes. And it's a different design. And that's the second screen he looks at. And Wade's theory from Record of the Republic was that these are the early versions of the Dark Troopers. And that definitely does help kind of lean into that. There's comments for all of us that have been wanting Sid to suffer. I think we got some indication that she may have been worked over by the Shadow Trooper because at the there's a comment about him locating the female Transdotion and that she gave up some information, and then that's repeated in the next episode as well. So I'm having a feeling that came from our friend Sid. And if she got a little hurt in the process, it's not going to hurt my feelings, that's for sure. Let's see what else. Like I said, Carr picks up the new kid from Bane. Bane makes an interesting comment to one of her questions, which is like, where did you get the kid from or something like that? And he said, asking questions like that, you give away more than you think, which obviously is a hint for her, where her character is going to go, because we saw her starting to bond with the kids a little bit. And then Jax, the little mini green giant, tries to make an escape but gets caught because security measures are tight enough that a kid can't just run out of there. But and that's kind of in a nutshell the movie or the episode summary. So DB, let's start with you this time, and thoughts on Identity Crisis.
Well, Filoni finally did it and had an episode without the main characters in it at all.
That's
true. The Bad Batch was not in an episode of The Bad Batch,
right?
So, it goes back to the Book of Boba Fett, where we had a complete Mando episode. But I think this was huge on character development. I think it's a matter of time until we see Carr defect, or at least attempt to. I loved the tension between Hemlock and Tarkin. Mm-hmm. I think, to play off Terry's other obsession there, we got a little bit of Game of Thrones positioning going on here. So I think that has plenty to play out in the future. And I still firmly believe that this is all leading to Poe Dameron's line, somehow Palpatine returned. This is the somehow. We're learning the somehow.
Mm-hmm.
So
for sure.
And I couldn't believe it. I was watching this episode and then the screen went black. I'm like, really? Has it been 26 minutes already? Crap. What a great episode.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Terry, thoughts?
Yeah. So, first off the bat, I'm not the hugest Bad Batch fan. Season one and season two were fine. It's always the word I use to describe the show. It's fine. I really did enjoy the Asajj Ventress episode, although I still think it had a lot of issues. This episode, when I got done watching it, I was like, wow, I just like that. This is my favorite episode. And like you said, the Bad Batch wasn't even in it.
Mm-hmm.
So I find that the episode that they're not even in it, I enjoy the most. And I think the reason why is because a lot of the season, it's been slow as far, because I understand they want to bring Crosshair back into the good guys. That was like a whole episode there, the whole Omega escape thing. I don't know why that had to be three episodes. I thought that was a little long. But this episode really starts moving the entire plot forward.
Yes.
Like, we know where it's going, right? Like we know. Like, it's been hinted at now all season long, but now to finally get those connective, pieces to move forward. What I'm really interested in to see now after this episode, and obviously we haven't talked about 11 yet, but what I'm really interested to see is, obviously Carr is going to either help these kids escape, and Omega's on her way there, so that's going to come into play. And what I'm really curious to see now is, so Omega, they never got the, what do they call it? The age. the age booster or whatever you want to call it. What is it?
Accelerated
aging, like car, because car did, obviously. I feel like, and in my thumbnail for my review on these two episodes, it's titled "It's All Connected," and I have arrows everywhere. I have an arrow from Car to Omega, and then Omega to Ray. There's something going on here, and we're gonna find out hopefully by the end of the season. But I really think that we need to make the sequels better, which I think we're doing, because at least this is making a little more sense than the Palpatine, Dark Science. You know, he came back because somehow, yeah, Dark Science. Secrets only the Sith know. That's so dumb. Oh my god, I play that so many times on my channel. It's horrible. we do not like that movie, but. To me, this episode was the best episode, and Cad Bane was just a bonus because I wasn't expecting that at all. And I'll tell you what, man, that beginning of that episode when Bane goes and gets that kid, I had to watch it a couple of times. I thought he killed the mother, and then I went back, like, okay, he set it to stun because I was like, wow, is that like dark?
Yeah,
so it was set to stun, so mom is still alive, thank god. This was a really good episode in the Empire. Somebody needs to call them on child abuse, because that is some big child abuse they got going on in that cell. I'll tell you.
Well, I thought you mentioned it earlier. People complain that, oh, the animation's for kids, they're cartoons for kids. Watch this episode. They literally shoot a mom and kidnap a kid.
Mm-hmm. I mean, shooting, and they stun the kid too.
Yeah.
Right. Right. You know, the only difference with the Jedi is they ask for the kid. So, you know.
There you go, right? The only question I really had leaving this episode was Tarkin.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Do we really think he doesn't know what's happening? Tarkin's a little higher up on the pay scale, I think. Mm-hmm. It's interesting. I don't know. I couldn't tell if he really did not know what was going on or if it was a test for this guy to see. I don't know. I'm a little torn on that because – I mean, I feel like Tarkin sometimes knew more than Vader did. I don't know.
Yeah, probably on certain things. I mean, so have you read the new Thrawn novels?
I haven't got through all of them, but
okay. Yeah. So one of the things that they do in there is they really depict how isolated the projects are from each other in terms of knowledge distribution. Everybody's working in their own pocket. So it's almost like the original Manhattan Project, you know, somebody's working on the Manhattan Project and then somebody else is working on what was one of the other projects in World War II. There was a whole thing where they were trying to train bats loaded with dynamite to unload waves of bats with dynamite over Japan cities. All the projects work in their own isolation bubbles. And the Thrawn novel does a really good job showing Thrawn, the master tactician, figuring out that there's a Death Star project going on because he's tracing the supply shipments that the Empire is doing. So Tarkin could, but I'm with you. I like the way they lay it out. You don't really know.
It was interesting. I always thought that Tarkin was basically like, he just kind of oversaw everything. And to have the special project, like, why would Palpatine be so into letting Hemlock run this thing by himself? And if that's true, that's fine. I have no problem with it. But where's that backstory of, I want to see the backstory there then. Why is he trusting this guy so much?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I agree with Rural Farm Boy here. I think Palpatine being the master of puppets tells people just what they need to know, not enough to make them a threat to him.
True. That's a good point.
And I think this early on, Tarkin is starting to do what Thrawn was doing, putting this information together to where he has to be close to Palpatine, you know, keep your enemies closer, that kind of deal. Right. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and of course then, you know, Vader's just his right-hand man for all the dirty work, you know, later on. But
right.
It is interesting that they kind of did leave it gray between Tarkin and Hemlock, but Tarkin's going to take Hemlock out. Let's face it.
In the books too, it talks about how the projects are competing. They're competing for funds. And so the Tarkin's line about the expenditures and the increase in expenditures is, you know, there's been other stuff that talks about that same kind of thing. Last thing I know I wanted to shout out was Steve Blum makes a return to voice one of the things. We know him as Zeb, obviously. He did one of the stormtroopers and one of the villagers, but the cast on this one was, it wasn't just D. Bradley Baker, that's for sure. It was quite the cast on this episode. So a lot of people got a lot of credit time on this. Any other thoughts about episode 10 before we move on to 11? All right, so let's move on to 11. If I can find my banner, here we go. Point of no return. So it starts off, I'm thinking Polis Massa, or Massa, however you want to say it. Fee's ship is going in for gas somewhere to get a top off. And to me, it looked like almost the same crater from the end of Revenge of the Sith. And so she's getting gassed up. Meanwhile, we see the CX trooper, the shadow trooper, sneaking on board, downloads a bunch of data from her Nava computer, I'm assuming, and then sneaks off. I liked her banter with her droid, talking about referencing if he gets blown up again, she'll just put him back together like she does every other time, which is
we need that droid as an action figure, by the way.
We do. It's a callback to that episode, that Indiana Jones episode she had with Bad Batch in was it last season? An interesting point that I thought, again, a piece of dialogue, when the Shadow Trooper's back on his ship, he talked about cracking the encryption on the on her information data. And so that's, of course, making the that line right there is making the tech believers say, see, it's tech again. But anyway, he finds a planet listed in the Outer Rim, and he's talking to Scorch, who will have a division on standby. And of course, we know we're talking about Pabu. And this is the episode that just like the last one was really filling in a lot of behind the scenes stuff. This episode really gets the season moving towards its the ending. I think, you know, it's definitely getting us on the road there. We go over to Pabu. Bad Batch is packing up. They're getting ready to go. Record wants an ice cone while they're down there in the shop. You know, cool little, I appreciate little details like that. Brings his character kind of back, because all season Wrecker hasn't really been Wrecker. He's really been quieter. He hasn't been the same jovial guy from the previous seasons. Batcher's kind of filled in that role. Omega decides to leave some tools and tech goggles in that museum place that they have that Fee fills up with all the artifacts. And again, another tech indication there, you know, a lot of people are jumping on board. We see the shadow guy or the CX trooper's ship coming in. Still love that design. I think that's a cool looking ship. He does like radar jamming to then go in and park in the same little cave hangar that Asajj parked in. This time Hunter's senses are actually reacting, and he feels like something's going on. So we get Hunter acting like Hunter again. Meanwhile, the CX trooper's scouting out the crowd. He spots Omega, which is the target. And then he calls in the division. They're on their way. And meanwhile, he's supposed to keep him grounded. And I know one of Scruffy's saddest moments of the episode, seeing the Marauder get blown up. Another toy bites the dust. And so don't open your boxes, folks. But the kids, we get to see those three kid clones that we saw from episode 2. As chaos is ensuing, as things are blowing up, as the Empire arrives, you see commandos and stormtroopers all over the place. I thought it was interesting. We saw no clone troopers. We only saw stormtroopers and the commandos. So what's going on with Wolf? Why isn't it his division? You know, again, there's probably another, that's probably going to tie into the cavalry has arrived at the end of the season, possibly. I don't know. So once the Marauder's blown up, they get Wrecker to safety. Their plan is to steal a gunship. That doesn't go very well.
Batcher runs off. I know when the stormtroopers were shooting at Batcher, I was like, no, don't go there. Don't go there.
Don't make me turn this off right now.
Can't do the ship and the dog in the same.
Right. No. And then Omega gets all self-sacrificing, Messiah complex, whatever you want to call it. And so then she convinces Crosshair to turn herself in to save the inhabitants of Pabu, and Crosshair can shoot a tracker on the ship, which ends up failing. And boy, there's going to be a dust up between brothers next episode, I'm pretty sure, when Hunter finds out what the plan they hatched. But yeah, so there's the episode in a nutshell. Terry, what'd you think?
Yeah, again, you know, I think the reason why they dropped these two is because the first episode didn't have any Bad Batch in it. I think that's why they did this.
Yeah.
But it kind of makes sense. I mean, they're connected enough, I think. Yeah, you know, again, another good episode. I really enjoyed it. And again, I go back to, I think I enjoyed it the most because we finally got to see the Bad Batch fail. They all failed.
Mm-hmm.
Wrecker got blown up, got a concussion or whatever. He got knocked unconscious. He's out for the commission. You know, he's out for the episode. Hunter, you know, he sensed something. He got in that gunship. He was able to do it, but you know, he was, you know, outmaneuvered, and he falls to the water, and then obviously Crosshair, you know, he isn't unable to send the tracker on. So I think that's one of the reasons why I liked it, because one of my biggest issues with Bad Batch in the first couple of seasons, you know, there's always obviously a couple good episodes here and there, but it's just always so repetitive. Yes, we know they're going to win. Yes, we know they're going to win. Finally, it's changing a little bit. And this is where the character development really comes into play. And this is when I really started like Crosshair this season. I've really never liked this character at all. Mm-hmm. He was okay when he turned bad, whatever, but that was fine. But this Crosshair is the one I like the most. And I also have a theory on who the assassin trooper is, though. But you know, we can talk about that after this. But you know, and Hunter again, Hunter, you know, he looks like Rambo to me, right? He got the he always wins. So I was really happy that he was able to kind of get, just you know, he's kind of like out of the episode for the most part. Omega coming up with the plan, I think that was really cool. I thought it was good. It was something I was not expecting that at all. And so that does allow her to get back to Tantus, where we know she has to end up being there again anyways. You know, that's why I was kind of frustrated in the beginning of the season, because why did we have to spend three full episodes of the final season with her escaping?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't know. And the first episode was okay because we got a little introduction to the blood and how they're doing the sampling and testing. But two more episodes after that it took. And I was so drawn out. And then the Crosshair episode was good, but again, it was long. It was just a drawn out episode, Monster of the Week type deal. Then we got the little, you know, their BFFs again or whatever. So it took four episodes to kind of get the thing moving here. But I think, like I said, the last three episodes for me have been the best of the Bad Batch that I have seen. I mean, I even made that the title of my video. Did I just watch the best two episodes of the Bad Batch? Because I've not been a huge, huge fan of the series. But now, after watching this episode, I cannot wait for the next four. And one thing is, in this episode, and then I'll let you go. I wish they would have killed Wrecker. I wish this would have been the episode. Because like you said, he literally has done nothing this entire season anyways. This would have been the perfect spot. And now, if he's dead, now we really are moving forward to the next four episodes, and the stakes are so high now. We know that they can die. You know, so that's the only thing I would have changed in the episode. Everything else I thought was perfect.
DB.
Yeah, I agree with you that the first couple of seasons, it was very formulaic of, we need X, but we need to perform Y for you in order for us to get X to move on to the next, you know, and it just kept building. It was very formulaic. And now this to me, and I said this to Brown Leader earlier today, this was the Empire Strikes Back of this series. Mm-hmm. Everything they did went wrong and failed.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And at the end, you're left high and dry thinking, holy crap, how are they going to get out of all this? And Brown Leader has some nice theories. I don't know if he wants to bring them up on the show or not. But, you know, the previous episode had been all character development, and it reminded me of the first episode of this season where things were repetitive and we're showing how boring and dry all this testing is. And you kind of see Carr get, you know, well, these are people. No, they're just numbers. They're specimens. Right. This episode was all the action that one was lacking. I mean, it was just action beginning to end. And I mean, I thought it was cool that, I mean, it's not cool because, you know, they're attacking this peaceful little village. But when Hunter tries to steal that ship, you know, and here you got the CX trooper, he's like, no, I'll just kill my own guy and save the whole thing. You know, I mean, wow, that's ruthless. And I think you and I have probably had the same theory on who this character is. So, but it was all action. You knew we were going to end up with Omega, you know, doing the ultimate sacrifice. This is kind of what we had in Ahsoka. Well, we got these characters back, but now these ones are back, you know, we just switched places, you know. So, wow, what a lot of fun. And I had forgotten it was a double episode till I sat down. I'm like, oh, cool. I get two episodes today. Brown Leader, tell us your thoughts.
I enjoyed it. And, you know, maybe the Marauder is just the first one of the batch that is going to pass away, you know, and that could be the start of that. I don't know. I'm really, really, really wanting to see the first 5 minutes of the next episode. I really, you know, it left me wanting to know, all right, when Hunter gets up to meeting up with Crosshair and Crosshair tells him what they did, what's that going to be like, you know? Or are they going to pull a fast one? And did Hunter sneak onto the ship before they took off? And he's actually on board with Omega. I don't know. I doubt it. But the way they framed everything, the way they shot everything, they could do it storytelling wise if they wanted to. I don't know.
We see Hunter go onto the beach, and then we even see him the rest of the episode.
Right.
I don't know if we do.
No, we don't. So we see it's mostly on Crosshair trying to get that tracker. It's them getting on the ship and then the tracker. So Batcher was down there. So he, you know, they could always work in where Batcher could smell Omega. I don't know. Who knows? But let's flip over to who is the CX trooper? Who thoughts, theories on that? Terry, we'll start with you on some.
The way I keep thinking something like, and I don't, the problem is I don't even know if the Empire has the ability to do this yet because we're still in this cloning process. So, like, my original theory was like, okay, so did they do something with Crosshair's DNA? And then they create like a clone of Crosshair, and that is who this is, because all of his abilities are so similar. Like when we saw it a couple episodes ago when he was hunting them down trying to get Omega, I mean, using that blade and just the way they're attacking each other, it was so similar. And then just the way he shot that pilot, I'm thinking, man, it's got to be something like that. I just hope it's not tech. I really do. I need the past to die. Like I can't have somebody else come back just because that's what we're doing here. I can't have it. I don't want it to be tech. I don't. But I'm hoping it's something like that. I don't think it's a big character. Like I don't think it's like a Barriss Offee or you know, like originally I did think it was Asajj Ventress when we first saw her, and as I thought the character was skinny enough, or like it could have been a female easily. Now, you know, I don't know, but so I mean, I guess I'm going with that theory right now. At least that's what I'm hoping for. Unless they have something better,
right?
I just don't want it to be tech. So,
DB,
it's Darth Maul. No, they bring back Maul anytime it's convenient. That's
right. That's the easy way to do it.
I tend to agree with you. They've shown us too many characteristics of the trooper being Crosshair, especially when he made that shot, you know, so far away. And to me, the voice just sounded like Crosshair. It's got that I just smoked two packs of cigarettes in 2 hours
yep,
you know, quality to it. But I, you know, I kind of think there might be a twist to it. If, and I'll be proven wrong next week, but if there's a, some sort of cloning technology, how do we know that's not Crosshair? And the Crosshair we know isn't a clone.
Yeah, I was thinking that too.
Yeah. Because you know, we don't know. We just don't know, because the shaky hand Jim thing is what gets me.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah. What do you think that is? Like, let's say that is Crosshair. What would be the reason for it?
The shaky hand. It was symbolizing that he was a broken man coming out of Tantus. You know, okay. He had been defeated. The looks when he would walk the hallways, not even making eye contact, kept telling Omega to just leave without him. Don't bother saving him. He's not worth it. He was just a broken man, just completely after the what was probably one of the best episodes of last season, with when he was on Barton 4 in the snow planet and taken out with that clone trooper Mayday, and they had to go take out the raiders, and it was just nothing for Stormtrooper armor. And then he shoots that real pain in the ass Imperial officer, and you know, from that point on, he realized the Empire was, they're just using him. He's a commodity. He's, you know, and ever since then, he's just been, I think, a broken man. And you haven't really seen it since you haven't seen the shaky hand since the meditation on the Fennec Shand episode. But I don't know. And as for who it is, I mean, they've dropped enough hints. Kudos. I have to wonder if the storytellers on this one, because it's not Filoni directed, it's Jennifer Corbett and Brad Rao, and so it's not a direct Filoni production, but I wonder if Jennifer and Brad and the rest of them have really listened to the fans over the last few seasons, because who is the spy? Who is Marok? Who is, you know, we love to theorize. We love to speculate. And just like there was no spy, Marok was a suit of gas. This could be, like DB said, it could be nothing. It could be a nobody. It could be, but boy, aren't we having fun speculating. The three leading ones were Tech, a clone of Crosshair, or a combination of Crosshair and Tech's DNA. Some people are even saying Cody, because of the way he fought with the knife on the waterfall scene. And then we don't know what they say. Cody went AWOL, but who's to say he did? I don't know. It could be any of those, or it could be a complete red herring. It could just be the next step up in what's going to become Dark Trooper, technology. And he's just the next phase in that first generation of it. I don't.
He could be a bag of witchy gas, you know, like Mirage.
Yeah, exactly.
So, you know, it's a great universe where you can put a helmet on any character and spark speculation. So.
Right.
I'd be all right with Cody, because at least we'd get him back and be like, okay, so this is where he went, or this is what they've done to him, or something like that. Yeah,
for sure. Okay, so we had as we said, we lost the Marauder in this episode, and I really wish Scruffy was here to see this, because I put together a quick little in memoriam for. So remember, don't open your boxes now.
It's a collector's item now. That's right.
It's a collector's item. So had fun throwing that together last night for the episode today.
You know, I called it last week. They're going to get another Marauder 1701-A.
Yeah. Another version of the Enterprise. What about the Katana? Yeah. There is always that possibility as well. So that's the two episodes, Bad Batch, episodes 10 and 11. yeah, some banger of some episodes for sure on that. So, all right. So next we're going to talk about, so as we mentioned at the beginning of the show, you know, we met you at ICCC last year, down in Nashville. That was our second year. And I think it was your second year as well. We were both in the podcast, stage building at that point. And we are now 6 months away from the next ICCC. No guests have been released. There's really no information other than it's going to go back to the previous venue, due to behind the scenes things going on down there. Mike has expanded it to 4 days, because of the smaller venue. So that's probably a good thing. Yeah. Last year ICC, there was some cool stuff going on. We got to see some cool guests in the podcast stage. Mm-hmm. I will be happy that we'll be back in the same building this year. That'll be nicer, even though it's a smaller venue. Yeah. We did feel a little isolated last year. But the ECPC TV crew does a lot they put on a good production for us. That's for sure. You know, they give us a lot of free airtime and I appreciate that. But guys, what are some memories that you had of ICCC?
Yeah. I mean, for me, it was really nice last year. Like you said, it was a little unfortunate that we were so far away, the podcast room. Cause like in the older venue it was at the part of the hotel. It's definitely smaller and but it's a little more, you know, it's closer together. And what I wish they would do is, like when you first walk in, they kind of had like their little show store and then they had a few of the guests. I wish that would be the main podcast room. Cause you know, whenever I go to a, I think of Star Wars Celebration. When you go to Star Wars Celebration, they have the main stage and that is right in the middle where people can just walk up and listen. That's what I would love to see. And I know, again, we're not talking about a huge area by, you know, anything, but that would be the most ideal thing is when people walk in, you're right there. We have the guests on there. People can just kind of stand I don't even know if you need to really have the chairs, honestly, for people watching. Cause I think a lot of times at a con, you kind of walk by, you listen to what's being said and you're not going to stay probably for the whole 15 minutes or whatever. You're going to kind of stay in and just keep walking. And I think that's what a lot of these cons do. You know, New York Comic Con does the same thing. Again, I know it's a much bigger con. It's, but again, they have Marvel has a main stage. People just kind of come walk up. They listen to the guests and you just kind of keep walking through. And I think that would be a really cool way to do it. If there was a way to do it. And I know like the area where the show floor, if you will, where all the collectibles are and stuff, that would be a really good spot because 2 years ago, if I remember correctly, isn't that not where they had the ad or something? Is that where they have that?
Yeah.
I mean, that's like a nice big space. So that's kind of right in the middle of the show floor. So if you didn't want to put it right in the entrance, that's another really good area, So, I mean, that's just me spitballing and a couple ideas that I want to talk to Jim about. And again, I don't know how far they are along with planning all that, that was awesome. I mean, the podcast sheets is always awesome. My biggest takeaway though was being able to meet Vanessa Marshall. Actually, I met her my second time and I was able to get her onto my YouTube channel. And so we did like an hour and a half interview last August. And you guys can find that interview. And she was absolutely amazing. I was able to interview Tia Sakaar, who plays Sabine Wren in Rebels. I interviewed her there. So, I mean, just the chance to even be able to meet these guests and these celebrities and just be able to have them, talk to you. You know, I don't want to say like they don't talk to you when you are just walking up for an autograph, but like I just feel like they do a really good job letting them know who kind of like we're there and we're there to, because they even on the podcast stage, Jim does a good job of having everybody come up on the stage and being able to interview someone. You don't really have to ask for it. Mm-hmm. You just kind of schedule, which is makes it really nice and makes it a little bit less stressful for us as well. Because I mean, again, we're meeting some people that are our heroes. Mm-hmm. A couple years ago, that's exactly how I met Anna Graves, who voices Duchess Satine. And I just walked up. I was like literally the only one at her table. And we started talking. And I decided, I'm in the podcast room. Is there any chance that you would be able to swing by? And I'll just, we can do like a 15-minute little interview if you have anything to promote. And she was more than willing to do it. It was awesome. So, beside that, obviously meeting, Ian McDermott has been there 2 years in a row, and I've met him like 3 or 4 times now. I have his autograph in so many different things. And then last year we had most of the Rebels group up there. So that was awesome. Steve Blum was up there, and his wife, Mary Elizabeth, was up there. And Charlie Cox was there last year. From Daredevil, the new one. Yeah. The new one's coming out soon, guys. This one looks really good from what the photos I've seen.
Yeah.
So, yeah. You know, and then just being able to meet other podcasters and other YouTubers like you guys. Rule of the Galaxy, Flynn Hendricks. Mm-hmm. You know, it's awesome. And me and Flynn, we talk every couple of weeks. You know, mm-hmm. it's awesome. I actually hooked Flynn up with another YouTuber that I got to know really well, and I got him on his YouTube channel to talk wrestling. So,
oh, nice!
It's awesome. Yeah, it's just the community that we built up there, as far as the press and that kind of stuff. It's really awesome, and I thank Jim a lot for that. I thank Mike a lot for that. I mean, I've had Mike on my channel as well, and it's really a fun con. It's a different type of con. It definitely mm-hmm. is. It's yeah. not your big New York Comic Con where it's just like you don't see anybody. Like it's hard, unless you go to a huge panel and then you're sitting, in the back and you can barely see who's on stage. It's not like that at ICCC. So if you guys have never been there, I highly, highly recommend making the way down to Nashville. And then you can go to the new Garth Brooks bar, which me and my wife are super excited about. We're actually coming to Nashville in June. We're going to see a concert. But we want to go see Garth's bar. We're huge Garth Brooks fans. So.
Very cool. Very cool. Yeah, I think you nailed it on the one point is that everybody's approachable. Everybody is just like, I remember the first time we were going down, I asked Mike ahead of time when I got my first press pass, and I was like, I'd never had a press pass before. And I'm like, well, can I talk to the celebrities? And he's like, yeah, just as long as you're not annoying them, it's all good. And man, is he right? And he only brings in guests that are approachable, that are fan friendly. And yeah, we had Vanessa on as well. Super nice. Mm-hmm. Just wonderful lady. And then yeah, like you said, and I liked your idea about what if they did put us in the middle of that area, because some of those interviews that we had, like
are so good.
We had we were like 3 of maybe a dozen people when they did the Anthony Daniels one. I mean, in a small little room. I mean, it was just so, and then last year I sat in a lot of them as opposed to the first year. I didn't really sit through many of them, but so many. John Rhys Davies. And then Steve Blum and his wife, best one probably there. That was hilarious.
Yeah.
And then
when we went to see Steve to get an autograph, I mean, he was like, oh yeah, you guys are in the podcast room. Come on up, And just, mm-hmm. It's that extra little bit because mm-hmm. we had been visible in the podcast room.
Yeah. Yeah. I just think more people need to know. I think people would stop and watch if it was in a bigger area.
It's
more on the upper, you built it up on a stage a little bit.
Yeah.
Where people like, oh, look, Anthony Daniels is right there. You get a quick little photo op. I mean, those guys don't care when it's that kind of situation.
Yeah.
I know at a table, it's different. It's mm-hmm. someone don't want the picture taken. But yeah. When you're far away and you're on a stage, they're used to that.
Yeah.
I've got some great selfies of me, with my back to Anthony Daniels going, look how freaking close I am to this guy,
But then his wife probably yelled at you. So,
yeah. But yeah, it's, you're right. Cause we were at Chicago Celebration, and you're right. That stage, yep. Whenever there were people on there, yep. People would just mass, and it was a cool environment. And yeah, I think, mm-hmm. That's a great idea. And I know we've got some ideas too. We were going to bring up to Mike, maybe because they have like the main stage where they do all the panels and everything. And I thought it might be kind of good. Let's do a podcast panel, and get a few.
That'd be good too.
And get a few of us podcasters up there and talk about podcasting and give it some more visibility. But you're right. In the middle of that room, we would have so much exposure, and not just us, but the celebrities. And it would create, there's already a lot of energy in that room, but it would create even so much more. I like that.
Yeah, they could put those dioramas out in that main lobby area and put the podcast right in. Wow, what a great, because I'm sorry, am I stealing your thunder, Brown Leader?
Mm-mm, mm-mm.
Because I think the first year we went to ICC, we were in that podcast room, which was off that side hallway there. Mm-hmm. And I don't think a lot of people knew It was there, because that's how we saw Anthony Daniels and some of the other people. There was yet one young lady who kept posting things over and over, and she was just a great interviewer no matter who was up there. I can't remember what her name was.
Oh, yeah. I know who you're talking about.
She was into more of the fantasy aspect, but yeah.
I think it was Ashley.
That sounds familiar.
I think it was Ashley, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, and I felt like we were really newbies into the whole thing, because, I mean, I was totally starstruck when Anthony DeAngelis was, you know, 10 feet from us. Mm-hmm. But then last year, we had this big open space in a completely separate building. That's what I didn't care for, was the hike over there. But so many people, you mentioned John Rhys Davies, you know, wow, what a great interview. And he stopped and said hello to everybody on his way out.
Mm-hmm.
Who did you get to? Spencer Wilding.
Yep.
You got to interview him.
Awesome. Yeah.
Scruffy and I sat in and interviewed Jim Swearingen just on a lark. It was like, hey, you guys want to interview Swearingen? I'm like, are you kidding? The guy who designed my entire childhood? Yeah.
You're right.
You know, people don't know that these podcasts exist, and so many cool people. And Jim Orman and his team are incredible. They make you feel so comfortable in that environment. You know, here I'm sitting in my basement, and I felt so comfortable sitting in front of all these cameras because they just make you feel so welcome. I hope you're right. I hope that Mike Havens is listening and we can do something a little more in public view this year.
Yeah.
I think being on the show floor would be amazing, because then when people are walking around, they're hearing what we're saying.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They're able to see the guests, and you leave a little area around the stage so people can stand there, you know?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah. That's all I keep thinking about is how Star Wars Celebration does it. And then New York Comic Con does it like that. You know, some of the other cons, they don't really have, like, they don't do interviews. Like some of the smaller cons, like, I've been down to, well, we were talking, you know, off camera, we were talking about Motor City Con. They don't have a main stage. You know, those guys go and do like a panel, right? Mm-hmm. They don't have podcasters or people doing interviews. You know, it's only certain cons that do it. But we have the people that are coming to this con to do this. And like I said, we have Jim and ECTV, and it's a shame not to just make it bigger. Make it bigger. And really be able to promote that, because I really hope that, you know, like I said, I hope Mike and maybe Jim are listening and they take this into consideration. Because I know I did talk to Jim last year at ICCC, and I said if we could get it in a different room where we're more visible. Because again, I mean, if you remember 2 years ago, you had to walk by like exotic animals and snakes. You remember that? Mm-hmm. And then we were right at the end of the hallway, so the exotic snakes got more visibility than we did.
Yeah.
You know, so
I know Scruffy loved that hallway.
Yeah, that's right.
The tattoo hallway was before we were, I think.
Yeah, I think so. But yeah, no, really cool ideas. And it is like Terry said, it's a different kind of show. It's very fan friendly. It's the nicest security I think I've ever met, you know, and again, how many times on the smoking bench talking to different celebrities, you know, I mean, just it's got a good vibe all the way around.
It's fan focused, and the celebrities being there is just a bonus.
Yeah. For sure. Okay. Well, let's flip over into collection corner really quick. I want it all. All right, so collection corner, and Scruffy is not here to lead things off, but I think we can safely say yesterday was Comic Book Wednesday, so he probably picked up some new comics, and I'm sure we'll hear all about those. And I don't know if you saw that, DB, but he was in the chat just a little bit ago.
I did see that.
Yeah, so he was chiming in, wishing he could be here with us. I think he just got out of work, so he'll probably be racing home right now, so drive safe. Especially, and I'm talking about the other people on the road with him, not himself. So,
having ridden with Scruffy, I say yes.
You're right on, right on. All right, DB. I know you were previously on a spending moratorium, and
I am on a further spending moratorium since we have decided to take a road trip to Motor City Comic Con in about 5 weeks. Mm-hmm. And if I'm going to even get in the front door, I got to stop buying stuff coming to my front door. So, so yeah, I have not purchased anything this week. So I'm super easy, and Scruffy's not here to tell us about his comic books.
Right. Right. All right. Terry, what's something that I know, cause you've got your big Funko guy, right?
Yeah. Big Funko guy. Even though I'm slowing down on Funko a little bit. Funko is kind of making me mad lately. I don't know what they're doing. They're overproducing. It's irritating.
For sure.
But yeah, I showed off one. So I did pick up these for the cons. I picked up Morgan. I do have her. I already have her autographed on my Black Series figure because the Funko Pop was not out yet when NYCC was here. And then I just picked up because Iman is going to be there as well. So I picked up my Ahsoka Ezra. Oh, and because his Funko Pop's not out yet. So I grabbed this instead. So eventually I'll get the other one as well. And then I have another one coming. It is not in. It's so funny. I bought this, gosh, back in 17 when I was at New York Comic Con, and I had the official con sticker, and I had sold it, a long time ago. And now, of course, finally coming to Cleveland is Andy Tudyk, and he's K2SO. So I had the Comic-Con exclusive. I could not find it on eBay, Mercari, nowhere. I could not get a con sticker. So I ended up actually going to Whatnot and just kind of doing a search, and I found one for like $15. So I'm like, all right, that's cool.
Excellent.
Yeah, so I picked that up. So that one is not arrived. That will probably get here tomorrow or on Saturday. So those are the three most recent pickups. The only other thing is I have... really nothing else. I just built a Lego set. That's basically it. Cool. So I built the Ahsoka ship.
So you might like this. It's not a Funko, but it's a Japanese bobblehead. And the glare is here's the back.
So but, that's Bulba, right? Yeah.
Yeah. Somebody picked that up for me years ago. Wow. Everything's in Japanese on it, which is very cool. as you can see, I've got a few Funko as well. Yep. Let me rephrase that. I've ordered quite a bit of stuff. None of it has arrived yet. So we've got some, I ordered some material that's going to relate to an episode coming down the road, a different kind of episode, one we haven't done before. We're going to do a joint episode with a podcast called Coruscant Knights. And so we're going to be dabbling in a little bit of role playing in the Star Wars universe. So I've got some source books coming from that. As we mentioned, we're going to Motor City in a few weeks. So I'm hoping to intercept the mail before the Mrs. Brown leader does, because I have a Carson Teva helmet coming, because we are going to do a group photo with him, and I also I'm going to do the autograph, so I'm going to have him autograph that for me.
I gotta get that beard going so I can look more like Carson Teva.
Yeah, I know, right?
We got the same dome, I just need the beard.
And then I've got I think I got some books on order. We've got some authors coming up down the road that we're going to have on. So I've got some books coming from them, and one of which will lead to a new segment that I'm going to unveil in a future episode. So something that will... the guys will respond. I don't know how, but they'll respond. I'll just leave it at that. So, that's all. I've nothing to really show off in terms of gaining. It's all on order. So I just got to wait for the delivery trucks. And I think it starts rolling in tomorrow. So, if I can get home before the misses. So
I did pre-order the Shin Hati, Hot Toys figure though.
Ooh, nice.
I had like $40 in rewards. I'm like, all right. Do it.
Mm-hmm.
It was either her. I had to choose. I'm not allowed to buy both. I had to choose between her and Baylan. And I love Baylan. I think he's probably the best character in that show.
Mm-hmm.
But, Shin Hati's pretty hot. So.
Yeah, you know what, Terry? I ordered Shin Hati, and what I got was a restraining order. So be careful.
Hey now. Hey, hey, hey. Okay. All right. Oh, there was one other thing I was going to mention because we were talking Funko. So they announced their, and I know you had some comments on there, I think about the droid. But yeah, there's the 25th anniversary for the Phantom Menace release that they're going to do for Funkos. So some cool designs. I can't tell if that's Maul on a speeder or not. I think it is.
Yeah, I think it's on a speeder, yeah.
Yeah, so those will be coming out. So those are kind of cool. But yeah, I know what you mean about the overproduction. There is just quite a bit. And it's like, I don't need a new line. I just want to finish the line that I started. And
yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'm to the point where I basically collect con pops that I collect. Mm-hmm. I collect NFTs that I collect. And then I collect Funko Pops to get autographed. That's mm-hmm. kind of where I'm at right now with it. So, mm-hmm.
yeah, when is it going to collapse like Beanie Babies? When is it going to be too much? That's a serious question. That's a serious question.
I mean, true. I don't know. I mean, some of these, I think the thing that Funko has going for them is that they have all these different IPs, you know, and having Star Wars and Marvel. And I mean, gosh, just those two alone are huge. You know, and it's just what really irritates me about Funko is that for what reason do we need another Darth Maul? Like, great, he's on a speeder. Okay, cool. Like, do we really need another one? Like, we have a million. Like, can I please get a Sage Ventress? Can
I? I've got like five Grogu's myself, and I don't even collect Funko's.
75 Grogu's, 300 Darth Vaders. I mean, let me get some characters we don't have.
Yeah,
but you know what else I think Funko has going for them is their price point is $10 to $20 generally, unless you get the deluxe. Whereas Hasbro is getting $35 for a croissant, and warming the pegs at the Walmart right now.
I mean, even the vintage, man, $17 every time. Like, come on.
Yeah, like I ordered price point.
I pre-ordered the, I did the HasLab for the Ghost. I mean, I had to do it. It was it looks amazing. So you get, God forbid they give you the whole Ghost crew when you spend that much money. So then they released the Sabine and Chopper 2-pack, I think it was. Mm-hmm. I think it was those, or Sabine and somebody. I think it was Chopper. So I had to order that. They're like $35 for three and three quarter inch figures. It's kind of insane. They're a little pricey, those guys over there.
Well, and they had to lay off how many people, and how much of their stuff ends up at Ollie's or Ross's, and they really need to rethink that price point. And I know even their brand new line, I saw just today, their brand new line, their affordable line that's actually meant to be played with by kids, $10 action figures already dropping down to $6.
That's what they used to be, $6-$7.
Hey, I remember in '78 when they went from $1.99 to $2.49. My parents are like, nope, not getting those anymore.
I always tell my mom that I'm like, yeah, I bought that Millennium Falcon you never let me have when I was a kid. Remember when it was like probably like $25? I'm like, you don't want to know what I paid.
You can't get the instructions for that for $25 anymore.
Yeah, I know, right?
Right, yeah. Oh, my gosh. Exactly the first time I went to, where was it? I think I was walking around with Scruffy at ICC that first year, and DB, you were off doing something else, but he was looking at the old boxes, like the cardboard boxes that stuff came in.
Yeah.
And I was like, and he's calling, he's got a dealer up here that he buys stuff for. He has a dealer up here, a Star Wars toy dealer. And, I heard him on the phone. He's like, well, they're not bad. It's like 150. And I'm like,
It's a shipper box.
Yeah. Seriously, a shipper box. That's what it was.
Shipper
box. And I was like, for that, I'd throw that away if it was in my garage. Okay. And that's when I started finally realizing just what this market is like. And it was like, it's crazy. It is. But all right. Okay. So that's Collection Corner. And before we start to wrap up, there's one last thing. So Terry, all of our guests on the show become honorary members of the Brown Squadron. So with that, you get a flight designation and a call sign. And so you are now Brown 47, and the call sign is Mikadrix. And where I pulled that from, I was trying to do some diving into Wikipedia, and I'm looking for swords, I'm looking for medieval, I'm looking for different things. Mikadrix is a character that was on a planetary defense force. He fought with the clones, even part of the 212th, which was Obi-Wan's. And then after some battles, he became really disillusioned with the whole war, seeing that it was really kind of a fraud, seeing through everything. And he formed Deathwind, which became execution group. They would go around executing people. And so Anakin and Obi-Wan were sent to track him down, and they found him with a sword made of clone bones.
Nice.
And dude. Yeah, so that's where I pulled that from. Viewers and listeners, if you want to find out more about Meekadrix, just type in the Wikipedia, and I might have to, maybe once we go around to M again, maybe I'll throw that in the M episode, but for Wooks Up. But yeah, so Meekadrix, so welcome to the crew, Terry. It's been a lot of fun having you. Like I said, we've been reaching out to all of our ICCC friends and getting them on the show, and since we're about 6 months away from the next show, but yeah, why don't you tell everybody and our viewers and our listeners where they can find you.
Yeah, you guys can find me over on YouTube. You just search for Headless Ned Stark. I think I put the link too in the private chat if you guys want to link it. Just do that. Instagram, it's just again, same thing, Headless Ned Stark with underscores, of course, because that's what Instagram does. So it's Headless_Ned_Stark. Over on the Twitter, the X, whatever we're calling it these days.
Twix.
Yeah. It's Headless_Ned. And then over on TikTok, you can follow me at HeadlessNedStark as well. So yep. those are the four platforms.
And just look for that logo right there.
There you go. So,
very fun logo. So, all right. Well, thanks for coming on. I hope you had a good time. And I think at this point, we're going to sign off. And so normally I'll do the sign off. And after that, we usually chime in with That's No Moon at the end. So feel free to chime in if you want. But yeah, go ahead, DB.
You know, Scruffy's not here. Can we change That's No Moon to Beam Me Up, Scotty, or something?
No, it's a tradition. That's No Moon. You know what? For something else for Collection Corner, I dropped another voicemail over to the Fact Bug Boys from a certain point of skew. And I even ended that voicemail with That's No Moon. That's how committed I am to that tagline. But all right. Okay. Let's get out of here tonight. I really appreciate you having you on, Terry.
Thanks for having me on, guys.
Yeah. And so this is Brown Leader signing off for the crew. And you, oh, wait, actually, what am I doing? We have an outro now, which I'll play.
That's right. That's what I thought you said earlier.
I did. So actually, I need you. So we'll do the That's No Moon. Then we'll do the outro while we wait for the system to cycle off. But I need you to pick a number between 1 and 3.
1 and 3.
Yeah.
I'm going to go 2.
All right. 2 it is. All right. So let's do the sign off. This is Brown Leader signing off for the crew. You have been listening and watching Hyperspace Heroes. That's no moon. All right. And let's get over to this. These controls are clunky. And here we go.
Was it good for you?